He was apparently a small man, according to Mr. Higgins, with girly features, curly hair, and the heart of a rascal. Mr. Higgins claims Mr. Shackleford was 103 years old when the account was recorded, though he writes, "It could be more. Onion had me by at least 30 years." While Mr. Shackleford is listed in the 1942 church registry, which survived the fire, no one in the current congregation is old enough to recall him. The congregation has announced plans to pass the account of Mr. Shackleford to a Negro history expert for verification, and later sell the notebooks for publication, with the proceeds going toward the purchase of a new church van. Part 1. Free Deeds. Kansas. Chapter 1. Meet the Lord.
I was born a colored man, and don't you forget it. But I lived as a colored woman for 17 years. My pa was a full-blooded Negro out of Osawatomie, in Kansas Territory, north of Fort Scott, near Lawrence. Pa was a barber by trade, though that never gived him full satisfaction. Preaching the gospel was his main line. Pa didn't have a regular church, like the type that don't allow nothing but bingo on Wednesday nights and women setting around making paper doll cutouts. He saved souls one at a time, cutting hair at Dutch Henry's Tavern, which was tucked at a crossing on the California Trail that runs along the Kaw River in South Kansas Territory. Pa ministered mostly to lowlifes, four-flushers, slaveholders, and drunks who came along the Kansas Trail. He weren't a big man in size, but he dressed big. He favored a top hat, pants that drawed up around his ankles, high-collar shirt, and heeled boots. Most of his clothing was junk he found, or items he stole off dead white folks on the prairie killed off from dropsy or aired out on account of some dispute or other. His shirt had bullet holes in it the size of quarters. His hat was two sizes too small. His trousers come from two different colored pairs sewn together in the middle where the arse met. His hair was nappy enough to strike a match on. Most women wouldn't go near him, including my ma, who closed her eyes in death bringing me to this life. She was said to be a gentle, high yellow woman. Your ma was the only woman in the world man enough to hear my holy thoughts, Pa boasted, for I'm a man of many parts. Whatever them parts was, they didn't add up to much, for all full up and dressed to the nines, complete with boots and 3-inch top hat, Pa only come out to about 4 feet 8 inches tall, and quite a bit of that was air. But what he lacked in size, Pa made up for with his voice. My pa could out-yell with his voice any white man who ever walked God's green earth, bar none. He had a high, thin voice. When he talked, it sounded like he had a Jew's harp stuck down his throat, for he spoke in pops and bangs and such, which meant speaking with him was a two-for-one deal, being that he cleaned your face and spit-washed it for you at the same time. Make that 3-for-1 when you consider his breath. His breath smelled like hog guts and sawdust, for he worked in a slaughterhouse for many years, so most colored folks avoided him generally. But white folks liked him fine. Many a night I seen my pa fill up on joy juice and leap atop the bar at Dutch Henry's, snipping his scissors and hollering through the smoke and gin, "The Lord's coming! He's coming to gnash out your teeth and tear out your hair." Then fling himself into a crowd of the meanest, low-down, piss-drunk Missouri rebels you ever saw. And while they mostly clubbed him to the floor and kicked out his teeth, them white fellas didn't no more blame my pa for flinging himself at them in the name of the Holy Ghost than if a tornado was to come along and toss him across the room, for the spirit of the Redeemer who spilt his blood was serious business out on the prairie in them days, and your basic white pioneer weren't no stranger to the notion of hope. Most of 'em was fresh out.